Thank you for tuning into the Pictures of Lily podcast. I'm your host, Lily Moayeri. I have been a music journalist since 1992, and I interview a lot of music-related people. This podcast, which is named after the song by The Who, is about my experience behind the story, to give you a snapshot of what it's like on the other side of the digital recorder. Pictures of Lily. Thank you, everyone, for tuning into the Pictures of Lily podcast. This is episode 42. You can find us on every platform by going to picturesoflily.com, where you can subscribe or follow us and also connect to us on SoundCloud, YouTube, Pandora, and Amazon, although it's really best to listen to the podcast straight from the source at picturesoflily.com, as it is the best quality audio without any copyright restrictions. I talk about my experience interviewing Wendy Melvoin and Lisa Coleman, whom you most likely know from their time as members of Prince's band, The Revolution. Here are a few snapshots of my experience with Wendy and Lisa. When Purple Rain was released, I was still living in Iran. I watched the movie on a bootleg Betamax tape, and while I was really into the whole thing, I also didn't know what to make of it. I thought Prince was super sexy, but because my introduction to him and his band, The Revolution, was through a scripted film, it kind of felt like they were all overacting at being musicians rather than real musicians. I, of course, had it all wrong, but that image of Wendy and Lisa as the women in The Revolution who were as noticeable as Prince was stayed with me. And then the video for Kiss came out. This is the video that has Prince wearing that midriff-bearing half tank top and super tight pants with the mysterious girl in the veil and the shades and Wendy. The video stood out for me for a number of reasons. One, Prince was basically dressed like a woman trying to attract attention, and that was clearly not accidental. The mysterious girl I felt was wearing a hijab like we were forced to wear in Iran, and she seemed Middle Eastern to me. Wendy was an absolute star, and clearly almost Prince's equal in that video. It was at that moment that I came to the realization of her as a real musician and a star in her own right. I never forgot Wendy's facial expressions or her interactions with Prince in that video. I recounted all those thoughts for Wendy when I interviewed her for the LA Weekly in 2017, when The Revolution went on tour, starting a year after Prince's passing. I felt Wendy really understood what I was trying to tell her about the Kiss video. She was nodding the whole time and almost finishing my sentences. We met at an Italian restaurant near her house here in Los Angeles. The whole time, I was very comfortable. It was like meeting up with an old friend, and I was able to ask her any and everything I wanted to about Prince. And she would answer, she wanted to answer, and she wanted to talk about him. One of the things she told me about her and Prince was, I was his minion before I was his collaborator. Before any of that, I was the fan. I continued to be his fan, but I had a tangible emotional connection and a judgment that was different. My relationship to Prince was strained toward the end of our relationship in the band. He had fallen in love with my twin sister. My sister and I are opposite sides of the same coin. As fabulous and beautiful and feminine and princess as she was, I was the ground-level, androgynous boy-girl who didn't know I had any looks and didn't have any antennas. That was how I grew up, and I had a twin sister that was like, I know it all, I can get them all. And Prince fell in love with her, so my relationship with him was based on family dynamics. Lisa was already in Prince's band before he became aware of Wendy and asked her to join. But unlike Wendy, Lisa wasn't a fan of his before meeting him. When Lisa came to Minneapolis to join Prince's band, he picked her up in his Fiat, they made no eye contact, and she instantly lit up a cigarette. The windows were up in his car, and he was coughing, and when they got back to his house, he called his management to say it wasn't going to work out with her. Then he heard her playing the piano in his basement while he's making this call, and he ends up saying, "Never mind." I interviewed Lisa at their studio at the Henson Complex in Hollywood, and this is what Lisa told me about those early days. When I first moved to Minneapolis, I lived with Prince's girlfriend, and she used Caress soap. We never use it in LA because it's too hot and it's all creamy. But in Minnesota, where it's cold and dry, I made the connection. Everybody uses Caress soap. Prince used Caress soap, and it always reminds me of him if I smell it. It's a stupid little detail. He had this magic shaving powder and Caress soap. He used the powder with a butter knife. He used to have these scrappy little hairs that were curly and hard to shave with a regular razor, so he used this magic shaving powder. He had this little cup and would mix it with a butter knife, spread it on, and then scrape it off. Wendy and Lisa are very different from each other in every way. Where I was instantly comfortable with Wendy and she talked nonstop, I felt I had to earn Lisa's words. But I did earn them. Relatively quickly, I think, for her. Everything she told me was very personal and very revealing and very valuable to me. Both of them said similar things about Prince as far as the image he wanted to portray to the public. Lisa told me, "Someone like Prince, who is so impressive as a human being in all areas, it is difficult to not completely canonize him. He's amazing, a gift to humanity. But at the same time, he was a guy we work with every day. It could get really stressful and annoying. One day he'd come in and be all excited and energetic and happy and want to goof around. Then the next day he'd walk in really somber with a cloud over his head, mumble in the microphone, and be a dick. That's real life and it's way more interesting. People always ask us, what was it like? What was he like? He was charming and funny, but he was also boring and repetitive and self-absorbed. Every show we played, we videotaped and we watched the show on the bus afterwards. Then at one point, he told whoever was videotaping the show to zoom in on him. He wanted to study himself. That was his way of working out, oh, that dance move worked, that one didn't, what's Lisa doing, why did you do that, that's stupid, or that's cool. That can wear on a person when you're working really hard and you're not sure what your ownership of it is. I think it was the normal human side of Prince that reached out to create the revolution. There's this sort of naive quality about each one of us that lent itself to our loyalty to Prince. We were totally dedicated to working as hard as he did. We were like his kids. We could make him proud or we could make him mad. It was set up like that psychologically for us. Wendy and Lisa also had similar views about the addiction that was responsible for Prince's death. Wendy told me, "When you have an artist of Prince's stature who is, to the public, so put together at all costs, he was perfectly dressed, perfectly coiffed, perfectly mannered. When they fall, the opposite side of that is, no one can possibly know the pain I'm in or how vulnerable I am right now. There's no way Prince would say to the world, I'm addicted to this stuff, I'm in such fucking pain, you have no idea, and I need help. Someone like him would never do that, ever. And he left not being accountable." What Lisa said was, "Prince died because of keeping up that facade. Nobody can live that way. Nobody can live that all the time. We can't hold people to these extreme standards. Age happens, and with that is not only the deterioration of your body, but the enhancement of your mind and your experience. You have so much more to give. Prince's youth was spectacular, but imagine him as an old man and what he'd be able to impart. Artists and movie stars and everybody that is superhuman needs to let people know, hey, I'm a person, I get tired, I'm getting older, whatever they need to, because that killed my friend." The accountability Wendy mentioned is something she brought up about the disbanding of the revolution also. She said that Prince made it seem like she and Lisa left the band to do their own thing, and in that way he wasn't accountable for the breakup. But that wasn't actually the case. If anything, the impression I got was that they were still sad that he decided to not continue with them and how he let go of them that easily. The shows they did after his death was their way of grieving and healing, not just for themselves, but also for his fans who needed to be weaned off of him in a way. One of the things that surprised me was that Wendy and Prince were in touch on a weekly basis until about 2 years prior to his death. And for the last year of his life, no one Wendy knew had talked to him or seen him. She told me, "He disappeared on everybody. I told Wendy that one of my cousins was a huge Prince fan and was going through some health issues. Wendy had me FaceTime my cousin on the spot, and they had a really sweet exchange. When we were hanging out after the Revolutions gig here in Los Angeles, Lisa's wife, whom I met at the end of our interview as she came to the studio with their daughter, and who handles a lot of the administrative tasks for Wendy and Lisa, told me that my story on them was special and different and captured something true and intimate that the others didn't, which, as you can imagine, made me feel tremendous. Wendy and Lisa did not stop after the disbanding of the Revolution. They were working musicians before that, and they continued after. They put out their own albums and produced music for other artists, and they are very established as composers in the film and television world. They won an Emmy for their work on Nurse Jackie, and just recently, I spoke to them about their score for Cruel Summer, which is the most successful show on the Freeform channel and one I became personally hooked on for Variety. It was exciting for me that they remembered me. We didn't talk about Prince at all this time, and for the most part, kept the conversation about Cruel Summer. But Wendy did ask me whether, as a high school educator, I felt the relationship between the young black kid, whom we both love on the show, and the football player was realistic. And that started a whole conversation between the three of us about how things have changed and are continuing to change in the high school environment and even younger, where inclusion is expected, and how we as educators have trainings on how to create a safe and accepting space for all students. That took the interview in a completely different direction that didn't end up in the article, but it was a positive exchange for the three of us to have, and it really made the two of them happy to hear, as they are early champions of inclusion, leading by the example of their own romantic relationship. And that's my snapshot of my experiences with Wendy Melvoin and Lisa Coleman. I didn't mention how excited Lawrence was about everything related to them, as Prince is one of his top most musical idols. The first interview with Wendy and Lisa is on LAweekly.com, and the second one is on Variety.com, and both of them are linked at picturesoflily.com. In the next episode, I will be talking about my experiences interviewing singer, violinist, and composer, and almost named twin Lily Hayden. From myself and my co-producer, director, editor, Lawrence Schroeder, thanks for listening. And if you have a chance to subscribe or follow the podcast on any of the podcast platforms, please do so. And please rate and review. You can connect to us on picturesoflily.com. And from there, you can choose your preferred podcast platform or SoundCloud or YouTube or Pandora or Amazon. You can also find the playlist for the podcast episodes on Spotify and YouTube. Thanks for listening. Pictures of Lily.
Lily?